A human birth is rare. Man is only one among 10 million animal species. How did we get a human birth? From time immemorial, scientists and scholars have been trying to find out the mystery behind man's birth. Though evolution and involution have been accepted, through millions of years from inanimate matter, man came through animate matter, plant life, animals, and thereafter got a human birth. How did he deserve to be this way? What did the adhikaratva, eligibility? One school of thought drawn from Indian philosophy is that we have done great deal of merit in the past births through sahasra kodi yoni, that is 1,000 crore birth and death, we became a human being. And therefore, we should continue to be human being in all its aspects. That's the theory of the Indian philosophy. Having been born as a human being, we are born in India. India is a great civilization. It's considered to be a Punyabhumi, Dharma Bhumi, Tapo Bhumi, Deva Bhumi, and so on. India is one of the oldest of civilizations. Some say 5,000 years old, others say 10,000 years old. Even now, that mystery has not been solved. What is the longevity of Indian civilization? Now, in spite of 5,000 years of recorded history, how is it that we have sustained the same civilization? There are 49 civilizations in the world, out of which 48 civilizations are now dead and gone, leaving behind no trace of their ancient glory. For example, Rome, which is a great empire, the Greek civilization, the Alexandrian, Roman, Inca, Maya, Chaldonian, Macedonian, Euphrates, Tigris, all of them have disappeared from the earth. But India has sustained her civilization for 5,000 long years, is still living and vibrant. This is in spite of 69 invasions. India was attacked 69 times. It had a cultural onslaught, 800 years of Muslim rule, 200 years of British rule. Still, India is as it was 5,000 years ago. That shows the vibrancy, the resilience, and the glory of Indian heritage and culture. If you go to now to Rome, mighty Rome, you will only see the Colosseum. If we go to Egypt, we can only see the great pyramids. If you go to even other places, they are all mere ruins. And therefore, all of us should know, how is it that India sustained the civilization for such a long time? That's because of a profound philosophy, culture, spirituality, ethical and moral values, and so on. In that sense, it has been said, every country, every civilization has a unique genius. India's genius is spirituality. By that, many interpretations can be said, but religiosity, spirituality, philosophy, yoga, meditation, concepts of law of karma, law of rebirth, law of order, and many other aspects are responsible for India continuing to be a living civilization. How 5,000 years ago we conceptualized that man, animal, and nature are in symbiotic relationship. Man worshipped at that time, still continues to worship even today, animal species and plant species. Like that, there are so many unique features of the civilization which ought to be learned by the succeeding generations to come. We are not thinking of just because India is an old civilization, everything that was done long ago is truly correct. Only those aspects, those concepts, those perspectives and principles which are relevant to current times, we only need to take into account. How is it that we were able to manage this? One reason is because India had profound thought and wisdom. One profound thought and wisdom or an ethical moral as approach to life is the fact that we have said long ago that noble thoughts come from every side. Ano Bhadraha Kratavo Yandu Vishwadaha. Gandhiji said, I'll keep my doors and windows open to allow all thoughts come into my room, but I will not be swept away from my feet. In that sense, India is the only culture which accepted all that was sacred in the whole world. For example, when conquerors went to Egypt, in the Alexandrian library, 100,000 books were burnt. Similarly, wherever civilizations went as conquerors, using religion on one side, ideology at the other, they destroyed animal species, plant species, human beings, and so on. They also erased their culture. But in our case, India never went out of the country either to spread the culture or to conquer or convert people. That's one greatness of India. We also said our ancient saying is that Udara Charitanam Vasudeva Kudumbakam. That means for the large-hearted person, whole world is one family. It is a very great profound thought by which India, long before we thought of this in communication, in travel and so on, has conceptualized of idea that the whole world belongs to one single family. This has been proved by scientific discoveries, how the genetic characteristics of all the races in the world remain the same. Another profound thought of India is her approach towards man, animal and nature. We should know, first of all, that right from the dawn of civilization, man has been fighting four battles. One battle is against nature. The other battle is against animal species. The third battle is man against man, based on religion, ideology, nationality, ethnicity and so on. The fourth battle man has been fighting from the very beginning is what is called man against his own divinity. The divinity within says, do this, don't do this. And that is also, we are always, though we agree intellectually that we should do this, but we practice otherwise. So these four battles have been going on in the world for a long, long, long time. And now crisis has come. 5,000 years ago, population was very small and abundant natural resources were there. And therefore man was living in harmony with animals and nature. But in the last 100 years, because the tremendous amount, rapid population growth, we are now 6 billion people, land remains the same, and consumption has gone up 100 times per capita, particularly in industrialized nations in the world. And therefore, in the last 100 years, much more damage has been done to what we call our earth, which we call in India the Mother Earth. We have been, because of our greed, avarice and overconsumption, excessive indulgence, wastage, etc., etc., the earth's resources are slowly being depleted. And therefore, the whole world is today in a deep crisis. Many scholars and philosophers think that in a few years from now, life may not be able to sustain in this earth, because of the pollution, or what I would call the grazing to the ground, overconsumption, etc., etc. And therefore, the ancient concept of an attitude towards nature is very relevant to the modern time. 1950, there was a conference in Rome which said that limit to growth. We can't go on growing continuously. We cannot sustain ourselves if we do that way. Later on, in 1972, we had a top international conference of what is called Summit Conference in Stockholm, which was followed in 1992 in Rio. In these two conferences, the damage being done to earth has been discussed in great deal. Each nation pledged that they will not overconsume, they will not pollute anymore, etc., etc. And the recent conference in 2002, we had in the South Africa. There, though at one end, we all were happy with certain things being done to restrain pollution, to reduce deterioration values and so on, still they have pointed out the dangers are still there, a long years to come. The Western concept towards nature has all along been on a materialistic secular, scientific, technological, rational, meaning thereby for economic reasons, for self-sustaining reasons, we are approaching nature. They all talk about exploiting nature, conquering nature, man against nature, whereas in India the concept is entirely different. We worship nature. Nature is considered to be the mother. Earth is considered to be a mother. Plant life is considered to be brothers and sisters. Water bodies are also respected. Vayu is respected, and so on. So India's concept towards the nature is one of worship, one of reverence, one of respect, an ethical, moral approach to the animal species. Can we see how even United Nations has accepted India's concept that Earth is our mother, what is called Matrutva Bhava. UN has now put up a large billboard in the UN building saying protect Mother Earth. Thousands of NGOs, individuals, scholars, so many electronic and all media are now appealing to man.